Dr. Manmohan. Another Manmohan was also my fellow surgeon, Dr. V.K. Tiwari. I see some senior faculty here, senior members, and dear students. You know, it is a horrendous task when you are asked to sum up critical theory in 10 minutes, 15 minutes. It has taken me almost 27 years of my life, and I am still a student. Some of the things that you have just heard, Bakhtin or Marxist theory, so I'll try to be as simple as possible. And I would like to share this with my students that most of the times critical theory is taken with a pinch of salt or like a quinine tablet. I took it too. I used to run away from my first period because it was critical theory and Dr. Vibhavan used to teach it. He used to take that class. It is strange that I am a student of critical theory today. I teach postgraduate classes, critical theory. I'm going to take up some of the major interventions. When I say major interventions, that have changed the way we are looking at our society today, the way we are looking at democracy today, and the way we need to look at man-woman relationship today. Yes, for a student of critical theory, it is very important that you start with Plato, you start with Aristotle, and I would say that even before that, you have to start with Pythagoras, Parmenides, Heraclitus. I'm sure when students take up any critical paper, their coursework, the syllabi, and their guides will surely address these concerns. There are diverse schools. In recent times, I have been churned or turned, there is something churning in our societies world over. And that has really caught my imagination. Was this universe, was this society singular from the beginning? Was this cosmos a unified whole from the beginning? What I have came to understand is that it was not so. The universe, whether human life, social life, animal life, was always varied and plural. But somehow, as times went on, different agencies, intellectual classes, dominant ideologies, created this big division between the rational and the non-rational. That is where the whole problematic begins, between the system and the entire system. So I'm not going to teach you about, of course, Plato's rational idea, absolute Siegel's absolute spirit. I'm sure you will take up those. I am going to talk about those major interventions which have destabilized these established concepts, these rigid binaries that have been created and which obstruct us from celebrating life. Today we are celebrating literature. What does this mean? For me, celebrating literature means celebrating plurality, celebrating diverse voices, languages, and thereby diverse life forces. This shift that I am talking about, that has occurred from the unitive paradigm to the disunitive paradigm, or from the singular to the plural, from the monadic understanding of life and to the heterogeneous understanding of life, has occurred because of the flux. Because of the cultural flux, the human flux, quantum physics, Einstein's relativity, feminisms, anthropologist research, and also because the dynamic principle on which societies or the universe stands has always been plural and dynamic. It has always been associated with change and flux. The problem arose because of this division that was created between the rational, which became the dominant ideology of the West. For me, this division between the rational and the flux, or what Bataille understands as the excess or the surplus, is of paramount importance today. I can teach you, I can talk about Plato, other classical critics, and we can move on from there to neoclassical. But I think, let us talk about the present times. Critical theory has much to offer us as our society stands today. As man-women relationships are struggling to find that dialogic dimension. As we are failing, the state is failing to establish a dialogue with the plurality of the variedness of human society. Diverse classes, gender, transgender. It is the excess, as Bataille says, which he also understands as a gift, which he also understands as an exuberance of sexual economy, that unsettles the established class. And therefore, our states become uncomfortable with the population that is asking for transgender rights or gay rights. The schism between what was the dominant ideology and what is called the marginal voice or marginal voices is causing today around the world, not just in India, so much of conflict, unsettlement. Chantal Mouffe, in her book, The Return of the Political, has very emphatically said that present democracies and future democracies will have to learn to deal with conflictual situations, because democracies of the future are going to be will have to negotiate conflict and dialogue simultaneously. You cannot leave the other, as Levinas says. You cannot leave the other and then form your gauge of totality, and through that gauge judge the other to be inferior or, in today's terms, anti-national. The flux that has taken place, the shift that has taken place because of all these information and technology also, globalization, is gradually denting and rupturing, as Althusser says. New thought comes from the ruptural moment of the overdetermined conditions of any historical situation. And that is what we are witnessing in major parts of the world and in India too. Whenever historical conditions are overdetermined, or there is a weakest link in history, or what Foucault says about mutation, there will be a new insight. There will be that new way of understanding life forces. Cultures, languages, sacred religion, all came under the umbrella of absolutes, various absolutes: enlightenment, rationalism, Hegelianism, socialism. In India too, other changing situations have finally questioned them. And what is happening today, the critical theory that is emerging for the past 10 to 20 years, in the last two decades, is beginning to, and especially after the collapse of fascism, though I sometimes wonder that isn't fascism existing in other guise, in some other forms, in our societies today. When you tell the other not to exercise their choice, not to exercise their choice of sacred, not to exercise choice of their language, culture, or even, let's say, a choice of a man and woman, are we not, in a very subtle way, determining the other's life? States, establishments, have ideologies, have to become very conscious of not imposing established viewpoints. rigid viewpoints. With technology, with information, as Brian Reynolds says in his book, Transversal Subjects, it is an extraordinary book in which he has used a computer data to understand the functioning of history, how culture behaves. And he says that cultures and histories are random. They are not linear. They are not one-dimensional or unified. Other problem that comes is that while theory is moving at such a fast pace, and perhaps theory in a way is prophetic and visionary because it comes from that ruptural moment, our state, our establishment is not in sync with these ideas. So therefore, Martin Buber, the idea of IDAO was born out of the fascist determination. Levinas' idea of the I being able to realize its authenticity only when the I is able to welcome, to receive the other's difference in hospitality, or Bataille. If you read the works of Bataille, it is a sheer attack on capitalism. Capitalism with its rational enterprise. Capitalism that cannot become a gift. In Shri Guru Granth Sahib, there is this concept of Daat. Now Daat is very much similar to what Bataille says about non-capital expenditure, that is the gift that you can bestow without profit. Only when societies, only when governments, establishments or the state learns to expend, to expect, do that expenditure where the calculation is not of the capitalist enterprise, only then you are able to have a society with potential. I would also like to say that major intervention was also made by the feminists. When Kristeva reintroduced the body of the woman from a non-object to a signifying object, she made a major revolution. The woman's body today, incidentally, we are celebrating a woman's day. I'm not much for these one-day celebrations at all. I think if we can understand these dialogic relationships between man and woman, between I and other, then we need to celebrate each other every day in justice, in equality, and in the principle of truth. When Kristeva introduced this body, woman's body, as the signifying object, she was denting the established concept of political sutak. Today you still have women being not being allowed in certain temples. Agitations are going on. I was viewing one on NDTV even yesterday. So she made this major radical intervention when she said that the woman's filth also signifies that the language in which a woman writes is also blood and filth. One of the lesser known Punjabi Sufi poetess, Piro, we know about Bulle Shah, we know about Waris Shah. My Guruji, whatever I have read and exposed to is thanks to Dr. Gulfagat. And when I was doing a paper on the Sufi poets, he said, you must read Piro. And I would ask you, all of you students, I'm sure some of you are doing masters in Punjabi and doing research, please read that work of that poetess, the Sufi poet. We read, of course, they are great, Bulle Shah and Waris Shah, everybody, we cannot, extraordinary work. But Piro's work is extraordinary. She challenges the Mughal established system through her poetry. I have also done a paper on Meera. Now most of the time Meera has been understood as a devotee. She married, she chose Krishna as her son. That's what her poetry also says. In my paper, I explored that how Meera chose an other alternative. An alternative that was contrary to the feudal system. But since she could not exercise that right of finding another lover, she chose Krishna with whom she could have that kind of devotional relationship. From Kristeva, we can move on to Helen Siku, Irigray. All these three women thinkers have made revolutionary significant contributions to how a woman, or rather a man-woman relationship should be. When Irigaray talks about gesture in psychoanalysis, she challenged Freud's notion of lack, that a woman is born in deficit. Her contribution was that no, the growth or the journey of a girl child to becoming a woman is different from a boy child. But a woman does not grow in deficit. A woman grows in surplus. Hers is a surplus energy that marks her body, that marks her language, creative writing, and her man-woman relationship. The same metaphor is found in Shri Guru Granth Sahib. Guru Nanak, in the sacred Granth, it is said that if the devotee has to attain the Vaheguru or has to have a dialogic relationship with the Vaheguru, then he or she needs to have the authentic plural energies of a woman. Like one, she is waiting on her bridal bed, waiting for her Kali. Such is the extraordinary explorations that these women thinkers have done to circumvent, to make an intervention into another kind of absolute that was established by male frameworks or the rational frameworks. I would also come to another intervention that has been made regarding culture. Now, culture that was primarily understood as a monad, as a closed unit, with the interventions of Bordeaux, Lefebvre, Lévi-Strauss, and Clifford Geertz, has come to be understood as a material culture. That there is certain kind of materiality related to culture which we cannot do away with. Each culture is an encasement which has its own specific ontology and specificity. But today we are gone beyond that. Within a culture, there are several cultures. So there again, any given culture with the diasporic movements, with the globalization, has to negotiate or be in dialogue with the local as well as the other, which could be global or which could be within your own culture. These are the major interventions made by some of the cultural thinkers. Other major intervention which has really changed my way of thinking is the Delusion Country, and by one of the other thinkers, that is Brian Reynolds. When Delusion Country says that capitalism both territorialized and deterritorialized. They have also brought in the concept of majoritarian and minoritarian discourse. Extraordinary understanding of capitalism, that capitalism marks you. It marks your body flows and makes you into a territory. It makes you into a territory which it can legitimate. But all at the same time, capitalism also provides that space of deterritorialization. Because it also provides opportunities. And in this context, I would like to mention two other thinkers. That one is Donna Haraway, she is a feminist, and Zygmunt Bauman. Now both these thinkers have brought in technology, information, and industrialization. They say that in today's world, when there is so much of industrialization, technology which is advancing so fast, information, Donna Haraway understands a woman's body as a cyborg. Half machine, half woman. And what does she mean by that? She is suggesting that a woman has a capacity to simultaneously negotiate multiple places, which does not allow the state to legitimize her flaws. The idea that I would like to elaborate of Zygmunt Bauman is peak experience. I once asked in my class, and because Valentine's Day was coming very near, so I asked my students why there are no Ranjas and Heeris anymore. And still you are celebrating, because then nobody was celebrating Valentine's Day. And that they didn't answer, of course, but then it set me thinking, and I went home and I was, and suddenly because I read this book prior to that lecture, it came to my mind that in today's time, when we are living such rapid lives, multitasking, full of pressures, there can be only peak experience of ecstasy. There can be only peak experience when you will be one to one with your sacred or with your lover. So this was another major idea that students need to take up. I also would like to mention the contribution, of course, in 20th century made by Freud, Lacan, Jenner, three major psychoanalysts. Of course, their theory has been countered, discussed in many ways. But Freud's contribution in giving us the unconscious, in telling us that there is a latent, and that desire is suppressed somewhere. And that desire, the suppressed desire, manifests itself through dreams and through literature. The signs and symbols that you use in literature are the latent, the suppressed, that cannot be articulated through a symbolic system or through a rational system. I've already mentioned culture. Regarding the cultural materiality, I mentioned to you Bordeaux, Lefebvre, Levi-Strauss and Clifford Geertz. Now the cultural disjunctive temporality in today's time, that you are living in your own culture, but you are also in dialogue with the other culture, has been clearly exemplified, elaborated by Fanon, Sayed and Homi Bhabha. Any student, and when I teach literature, I tell my students that the literary text is a cultural product. It is a biographical product. You cannot separate the text from culture, history, or the biography. And therefore, any student who wishes to enter into critical theory, into understanding, should need to also understand these thinkers. I am going to close up my elaboration of these major interventions by saying that today there is a grave need that we begin, our students should begin by incorporating ideas, I see young minds today much more open to such ideas than we were. And that is perhaps the need of the time as well. That we need to shape our societies, we need to shape our democracies and reorganize our democracies and reshape our man-woman relationship in the light of these ideas. The rational and the excess. The I and the other. That the other has to be celebrated. I, any kind of totalitative I, can only lead to dictatorship, dominant ideology, totalitative regimes, where the plural voices will be suppressed. But what gives me hope is that I find more and more that these plural voices are not going to be suppressed. Derrida, I'm mentioning last because all of you know Derrida from De France, signed under A. Rajwan. But the concept that has really influenced me of Derrida is his notion of justice as a gift. Derrida elaborates that future societies and the present societies need to be organized on the principle of justice, which he says is a gift. And then each of us, the I and the other, the state to its people, man, woman, if we can gift justice, equality and truth to each other, we will be living in a better society. Thank you very much.